Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nick Larigakis. I'm president of the American Hellenic Institute. And as Brett Musburger used to say, a famous American sportscaster, you are looking live at American Hellenic Institute headquarters, Hellenic House, of which I am personally at right now. Today, we are a little bit outside of the genre of what many are used to regarding the American Hellenic Institute and our goals and objectives, which is public policy in the Eastern Mediterranean. We're going to talk today about something that for many of us who are interested in sports are all eager to find out where we're heading, and that is the current state of sports in America. But it is not completely outside the realm of the American Hellenic Institute to talk sports, because we do have two events a year that have to do with sports. And one of them is our annual golf tournament sponsored by Calamos Investments. And this year's 17th annual tournament will take place on October 19th. God willing, coronavirus by then will allow us to do so. And what's been a highlight of this particular golf tournament every year is a breakfast sports panel, of which some of the participants of that panel are going to be with us here on this panel here today. Additionally, today would have been our 7th annual Greek Heritage Night at the Philadelphia Phillies Baseball Stadium in Philadelphia. AHI has cooperated with the Philadelphia Phillies to bring and promote Greek heritage to a Major League Baseball venue. And unfortunately, there is no baseball right now, so this was a good opportunity on this particular day to host this panel. So, sports in America, obviously all of us who are major sports fans are very eager to get started with watching our favorite athletes on the hard court, on the ice, and on the grass fields across America. But more so than just providing entertainment to us who need it to get away from our everyday mundane lives and to bring a little bit of hope and back into some normalcy. Sports in America are also a major economic provider to the country. It employs over 400,000 individuals in all facets of sports. During the time that we have been locked down and sports have been canceled, there has been $6 billion lost in the U.S. economy. How many people watch sports? 102 million watched the Super Bowl in February. The 7th game of the World Series in 2019 against the Astros and the Nationals for Game 7 had a 23 million viewership of the United States, but averaged 14 million over the 7-game series. In short, sports is extremely important to the well-being of the United States, and we are eager to see our heroes and our sports teams back in action. To have some discussion on where we are headed in the middle of this coronavirus and will we have sports anytime soon, we've gathered a number of prominent individuals who are involved in the sports world with us here today, all friends of the American Hellenic Institute. Christine Brennan will join us shortly. She's running a few minutes late. But Christine is a USA Today sports columnist and commentator on ABC. And she has covered the last 18 Olympic Games of summer and winter, and has been one of the country's top 10 sports columnists 3 times by the Associated Press. George Veras, if I were to read his bio, would be here for a half an hour. But George Veras is involved in sports and live entertainment his entire life. He currently is the chief operating officer and executive producer of the Pro Football Hall of Fame, a 10-time National Sports Emmy Award winner as writer, producer, and director of national television live events and documentaries since 2016. And I remember the name George Veras when I used to watch the NFL out of my black and white TV set in New Jersey when the words George Veras came across the scene as the producer of CBS Sports back in the day. George, welcome. Tommy Green is somebody I've gotten over the course of the last 4 or 5 years in my various capacities with the Philadelphia Phillies. He is a 8-year former Major League Baseball pitcher, drafted in round one of the 1985 MLB draft, played with the Atlanta Braves, Philadelphia Phillies, and the Houston Astros, and he's currently a baseball analyst for NBC Philadelphia. And Tommy Green has one of the rare privileges of being one of those pitchers in Major League history to pitch a no-hitter in 1991 against then the Montreal Expos, which is today the world champion Washington Nationals. We welcome Tommy. What can I say about Larry Michael? Larry Michael is a very close personal friend and no stranger, obviously, to the American Hellenic Institute family. Larry is the chief content officer and senior vice president and voice of the Washington Redskins, which is to say that his voice is heard every Sunday afternoon in the fall when he is doing the play-by-play for the Washington Redskins. He is a 12-time Emmy Award winner. His resume includes 8 Olympic Games, 21 U.S. Open Golf Championships, 12 Master Tournaments, and 12 Super Bowls. So without further ado, and Larry, because, you know, we don't want to have any spare no production expenses here. So I want to give you a proper cue as now, ladies and gentlemen, we have Larry Michael to take us through.
You spared a few expenses there, I think.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Thank you. If I start, Nick, and I think we want to have some opening statements from our panelists. For me, I think the best way for me to open this is to tell you where I'm at, what I'm doing here today. Of course, which would have rather been live with everybody at one of Nick's events. But I'm actually at Redskins Park in Ashburn, Virginia. I'm one of the few people who is in the building right now. On March the 13th, we were sent home because of the quarantine situation. And on May the 19th, a select few of us were asked to come back to the building to slowly begin the process of people getting back to work. And we have a TV studio here, and this is where we do our work. Up until then, Zoom calls, doing shows from my den. It's amazing how much you can learn when forced to, technically. But we got through it, and there's a long way to go before we know how football is going to look in 2020. I'm very optimistic. I choose to be optimistic as to what's going to happen. I believe that time is on the side of the NFL, and we're going to talk to Tommy about time maybe not be on the side of baseball and some of these other sports. But the league has kept pace with every marker, every scheduling marker, the draft, free agency, the schedule release, and now we're kind of in a position here where teams are not allowed in their facilities yet, and the league wants to have it be a level playing field. Virginia, where we're located, for instance, is not open up for business yet, and some people wonder why, but slowly but surely everybody will get back. But for the NFL, they want everybody back at the same time. They want all teams to have the same preparation time. For the Redskins, it's a first-year head coach, new staff, obvious disadvantage on bringing a new system on board, with no time to really plug it into the players personally, but they got to deal with it. It's like we got to deal with it in everyday life. And so great to be with you guys today. We encourage you to have some questions ready for the rest of the program for all the panelists. And Tommy, tell us how you're doing and what is your opening statement. Tommy Green, former Philadelphia Philly, Houston Astro, missing the team. I'm missing one team there. Tommy, who was the team I'm missing?
The Braves, who I come up with. That's who I drafted with, yeah.
That's exactly right. I've gotten to know you from the golf tournament. Great to have you on board.
Oh, yeah. Thanks for having me, guys. I tell you what, I'm up here in the midst of things more, I guess, is what you want to call it, like I was telling Nick earlier. I'm up a little bit north of Philadelphia now, close to New York City within, an hour and a half or so. Things up here tend to be a little more, cautious. There's some, the Jersey Shore up here, as you heard and probably saw in the news and stuff in New Jersey, sort of opening up a little bit and testing the waters during the holiday weekend. So everything's a little cautious up here, which leads us into the sports side of things with baseball. My statement on that, with the way things are going with the new proposals that was put out yesterday by what I heard and saw, was sort of disappointing a little bit. And I guess my opening statement, if you hit on it a little bit in your statement, was the fact it's sort of, if we don't get something, we're running out of time a little bit as far as to have that type of positive season possibly, I think. With like they're looking at an 82-game schedule. Can that happen? Yes, but they got to get over some hurdles here. It's almost like we're going through a collective bargaining agreement again, and they're going to be going through it again next year when it's due up at the end of 2021. So, I mean, it'd be 2 years in a row they have to do that. And if they don't come together at some point, you know, it's going to leave a couple black eyes. It's not going to leave one. It's going to leave a couple. And the fans are not, you know, they've already voiced their displeasure about things and about the money side of things. I think there's got to be a compromise at some point, and I think everybody agrees with that.
Tommy, great to have you on the panel. And George, also a personal friend of mine, and he is out there in the state of Ohio, I believe. And George, I'm sure you have a well-prepared opening statement.
If I can only match yours, Larry, but maybe you can get us on for the Masters to play on the course since you were there three times. I mean,
I agree.
That's really the ask here, right, Tommy?
I agree with that one.
Oh, there.
No, absolutely. It's a pleasure to be with you gentlemen, and I just want to take a very quick moment. We know him well, the passing of the great Eugene Rosides, who founded the American Athletic Institute, just a tremendous, and speaking of football, played as an All-American with Sid Luckman, who was at the Hall of Fame in Columbia, as a side note, and I had the honor of producing a documentary on public television on Cyprus in support of his efforts. To him and his family, our sympathies. We're doing great here in the state of Ohio. The Hall closed down just like the Redskins. You know, we're not the NFL, but we obviously honor the NFL's history and its heroes in our mission statement here at the Hall. The Hall shut down on March 12th, but we came back to work yesterday for the first time as a staff, the senior management, social distancing for 6 hours. Our museum is fully prepared to open up. We have our proposal in front of the governor, the Cleveland Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is opening up. We should be open up sometime in the next 2 weeks. But to follow what Larry said about the NFL, and Tommy, I sympathize with those baseball fans and that not happening, and we hope it does. But, you know, the NFL has taken this stand, and we're just going to proceed as normal and try to get everything in order. And we kick off the season in Canton with the preseason game, which is the Dallas Cowboys and the Pittsburgh Steelers. That is on the schedule. We then followed with the Gold Jacket Show when the class of 2020 would get their gold jackets. And then Saturday night, the iconic enshrinement. What's so interesting about this is we literally put tickets on sale to those events as we were entering the first week of COVID. We sold out the game, we were on our way to sell with enshrinement, and we sold out the gold jacket. I can tell you today that only two fans have asked for a refund. And one guy from Australia, they wouldn't let him out of the country to travel here. So the fans are hoping, as we're hoping, and as Larry said, the training camps have to open up altogether. They're letting people in the building know. The governor of New York said the Bills can go back into the building slowly but surely. But the players have to have enough time to train to get to the schedule as is. That's piece one. Piece two is obviously the whole question of who can get to attend the game. So we're waiting from the governor, and I think in time we'll know if we can have a full stadium to have the event. But we, like everybody else, are preparing contingencies. You know, if the season pushes ahead to September, I mean, we're looking at contingencies for next year to create what actually would be a quite unique double enshrinement week. Because it's not just about doing it on television, but this event is huge for the region and the city of Canton. So to do as a TV event without fans and not let the Gold Jackets be together, we could do a show like the draft show, Larry. So right now we're hopeful like you are that everything can proceed. We're thankful for what the league is doing. And we pray that we have a chance to be able to do it this year. But if not, we'll be ready.
Well, you know, the title of this is The State of Sports in America. And as usual, when Nick lets me post something, I will hijack it to some degree. So I'd like to start off with a question for both you gentlemen. State of the sports fan in America, as we're a couple months into this. And Tommy, first you, because I think there is a frustration you can feel. Here in Washington, this team hasn't even been able to celebrate a World Series championship. The fans are so hungry to be part of that type of celebration. So what's your sense? Because you're out there a lot. And I know you're not that out there during a quarantine, but you know what's going on in the market, the Philly and up towards New York. What would you say is the state of the sports fans' mentality? Because they seem hungry and almost to the point where they would attend events, even if that was not recommended.
I mean, you hit it right on the head right there a little bit, because I think it's gotten to the point now with the fan. They're looking, they want something to happen. They want to be allowed to test the waters, like I said earlier, a little bit, because they do miss their sports. It's their outlet. That's one of the reasons I'm so glad I live up here in the region up here, is the passion of the fans in the Northeast for their sports teams, not just baseball, everything. I mean, it's a way of life for some of them, and it carries over into the athlete. It's good for all of us. And I hate to see some of the depression side of things. I hear a lot of things out there with the fans that they're scared a lot of negativity is going to happen because of this. That's why I said something about the black eyes in the opening statement, if the two sides can't come together. But I do believe they will. But the pulse is, I feel like they would attend if they let them get that close to each other. That's why I said it's so important for they got to have the rules in place. They got to have, this is what we're going to do. This is what we're going to, when we open this thing up, this has got to happen. You know, and they got to be, and they got to stick by what they say. And then they got to gradually start, you know, making it a little bit more and more and more. And hopefully we'll have, by then, have some kind of vaccine and being able to do something. Hopefully it goes that way.
George, you mentioned it in your statement, how the game sold out, the event sold out, and you've only had two refunds. You see NASCAR comes back without fans, and they've run about four or five races already, but project it down a month down the road. I would think sooner or later, these sports are going to have to start allowing fans into the parks.
You could speak to what that revenue stream is. Yes, the NFL teams can live on the TV money. Yes, they can get that, but a lot of teams still pay full salaries and will be hurt by not having concessions and full fans in stadium. I mean, the example for us is how hurt we could become, is that under social distancing, we've mapped out our stadium. We've been in touch. We know what the NFL regulations are. We've talked to NASCAR. Our president, David Baker, has talked to other sports leagues. So we know the rules and regulations. Our stadium security people have mapped out. So in a 22,000 seat stadium, we can have 3,000 people. Hi, Christine. Why don't you welcome her first? I don't want to.
Christine Brennan is here.
Hey,
hi. Hi, Christine.
Hey, George, long time. Larry, hi, Tom.
Good seeing
everybody.
Good to see you, Christine. Christine Brennan, the great Christine Brennan, is here. And you know what? We give everybody the opportunity to have an opening statement. I want George to finish his statement, and then we're going to go to Christine for an opening statement. We're basically talking about kicking it off, Christine, about the title of the forum is the state of sports in America. But the way I twisted it with the first question was the state of the sports fan currently in America. So, George, why don't you wrap up your thought, and then we'll...
So, Christine, I was mentioning, you probably know, we've already sold out all our events. We're in sync with the NFL schedule, but that's only one part of the equation. Will the game go on, and what the governor will let us have in the stadium? So we've looked at our stadium. We're talking about the economic difficulty here. And it's a social distance. We could only have 3,000 out of 23,000 in the stadium for an event that would cost us the same amount of money. So even with the TV money, be a huge loser. And that's where even the NFL is going to face that, as NASCAR is going to face that. Yes, they're on TV, but no fans or limited fans. And when the if will happen, and does it happen at a level playing field for all 32 teams, including the Pro Football Hall of Fame being. But one thing I would like to mention is we're being looked at by the league and the broadcasters as sort of the dummy test for the league. It's not the first time that's happened at the Hall. We were the ones who had the clear bag policy first tested at the Hall of Fame game so that the league could see how the procedures work. And for instance, in talking to our broadcasters, ESPN and NFL Network, they're only going to bring cameramen because they've learned that trick from the draft. They're going to switch everything back in Bristol and in Culver City because they're trying to limit the number of people too. But for fans, the other final question, I'll let you go, Christine, is how do you pick those 3,000 fans? If you sold 23,000 tickets, how do you pick them? And how do you take care of the other 20,000? So the problem with this ambivalent situation, it always raises more questions than answers. Thank you, Larry.
Christine, long time no see. Great to see you this way. Can't do it in person. So what are your thoughts on that? I mean, I'd love for you to give an opening statement and why you're participating in the forum again, but why don't we ask you to do both, state of the fan and also your opening statement.
Absolutely, Larry. Thanks. Well, hello, everybody. And again, my apologies, not again. Hello, again. And then my apologies for running late. I had an appointment downtown that ran a little late. And so sorry about being late to this wonderful event. And of course, Nick Larigakis, wherever you are out there, that's Nick.
He's the logo. He's the logo.
Nick is, it has come to this in the pandemic. Nick is a logo.
I'm here.
There he is.
There he is.
Nick, thank you. Thanks. And to your whole AHI gang, we've said this before, my heritage, I'm half Swedish, quarter German, and a quarter Irish, but I'm all Greek. Thank you for making me an honorary member of your wonderful family, George. We've worked together. My God, we go way back. You put young me on television. Thank you for that. I'm still doing TV, so that must have been okay. You got me on my way, gave me that launch.
It's all you. You're good.
Well, thanks. This is my shot, actually, for CNN. So this is what it looks like. And Tommy, always great to see you in person. And then you go on the golf course and you kill it. So great career. And congratulations
Thank you, ma'am.
To you. We're lucky to have you as a bona fide all-star. And Larry, Michael, how many zillions of shows have we been on? And of course, the voice of the Skins and the new Skins, I think with Rivera, I think it's going to be very, very interesting whenever we have games. But Larry, you and I have done zillions of TV shows for zillions of networks over the years. So
for no money, for no money.
Right. I think I got a couple $100. You didn't get paid.
That bounced.
Well, we're getting paid now. Not right now, but we're lucky kids. And I mean that. I know all four of us feel this way. And Nick, I know you do too. You know, we're so fortunate in the midst of all the sadness and heartbreak and grief, you know, to be healthy and safe and to be able to do what we do. And I never lose sight of that ever. And to be a sports journalist now, 35 plus years and doing what I love, I'm so lucky. And you have to have some luck. And in addition to hard work. So, and whatever else you got. So I do feel very fortunate. It's an honor to be on this panel. I think we are in the most interesting and uncertain time, what George was saying, I agree, we've ever seen in sports and in our world. And I love the fact that all these leagues are coming up with plans, right? We love that. I want to see baseball as much as anyone. I want to see the NBA finish up. I want to see this NHL playoff format that they came up with yesterday. Sounds like an NCAA tournament kind of thing. It sounds very cool. I want to see all of it, all of it, all of it. I'm not so sure we're going to see any of it this year. Now, with that, we've already got golf, and golf was social distancing before there was social distancing. So golf can pull it off, and that show the other day got great ratings and the match, and it made even more important, $20 million for COVID-19 relief. I mean, bravo, Tiger, Phil, Brady, and Peyton Manning. I mean, bravo to them. In the rain and a deluge and the funniness and the Brady's putting his pants and holding it out on the seventh. I mean, that had it all. So we can see golf could pull this off. And I don't even know if you're going to really miss fans on the broadcast. And George knows this far better than I. Larry, you do too. But, you know, for most people, TV, sports is a TV show. And of course, that's where a lot of the big money is too. And that's why, for example, MLB wants to play. Not only do they want to play, players want to play, everyone wants to play, but there's $1 billion sitting there with the TV rights. And so there's, for most fans, I think they'd adapt very quickly to sports without spectators. And there's that cool Danish soccer league that's talking about putting up huge screens of Zoom. So in the stadium, it wouldn't just be a small screen like what we're on now. It would be this huge screen with Zoom of everybody, all the fans cheering, and you could have the road team and the home team zooms, and that sounds interesting and very futuristic. But I do think there's real doubt about how do we have football in the midst of all this, where everyone's on top of each other every play. I hope we have high school sports. My niece is a great volleyball player. I'd love to see her play in high school this fall. I hope we can have college sports. I so do, but I really think there are some major questions about whether we can pull this off until we get a vaccine or at least some kind of treatment.
With that in mind, I think a logical next question for the group would be, You know, how do all these different states reconcile with the different leagues? How is it possible for these different states? And again, I know Christine's probably in Washington, D.C., which is different than Virginia, which is different than Ohio. Tommy's up there in Jersey area. So how do these leagues reconcile what the states are saying are the requirements for gathering? Or do the leagues have some special dispensation? Some of these groups, I mean, I guess NASCAR had to go through those states that ran their races for some type of approval. Do y'all have any kind of opinion on that?
That's a good question. That's something I really don't know a lot about at all, but an opinion on it is, I mean, I sort of touched on it while ago, was that they got to come together with some Major League Baseball with some type of plan of what they're going to do, what they're trying to accomplish, and they got to go to the rights to be. They've already in the proposal trying to get the leagues, the teams closer together. Okay, the Phillies are going to play the Mets and New York Yankees and maybe Boston and down to, and the Orioles and even the Nationals, and keep everything in the Northeast corridor up here, which is sort of, that's the game plan. And that way they're not having to travel and go, like Phillies, go out to Missouri. Or I was just talking to one of my good friends I played with, Danny Jackson, out there in Kansas City, said they haven't been affected like we have here. But you're also, the big word yet comes in there if you start opening up to do things. Allowing people to gather like that. And see, that's the big question about having everything, the procedures of what they're going to do, the testing before each game, or what the requirements are going to be. They're still up in the air a little bit about things. And one I saw today on one of the players said, I think he was with Colorado, Charlie Blackman said, as far as the spitting type thing, they're trying to ban that from baseball. I don't know how that's going to happen. That's sort of a habit that it's been a fabric of baseball since I've all known it. But they got to come up with some kind of thing, and it's got to be mutually agreed on. It's sort of like with the states, the teams, the players, and the association, the union and the Major League Baseball are trying to hash out things now, but also the states have got to get together too and allow, if they're planning on having sports, NFL, baseball, whatever, hockey, are they going to allow fans or at some point allow fans? Are they going to open up their cities and their state to this? And then they got to agree on it so we can get this going. If not, I think we're in jeopardy, like Christine says, of not having it this year.
Christine, is that the basis of your theory? How can you get all this done? How can you get all these approvals to sync up? To me, that seems like the toughest thing.
I think it is, Larry. And Tommy articulated it well just by talking about your friend in Missouri. And it would be nice if we had a national policy. I know we're not going to get into politics. I'm not going to get into politics. But if we had a national policy, then to the point that you were making, Tommy, Kansas City hasn't been hit yet. Hopefully they won't be. My goodness, of course, no one wants this for anyone. But you looked at that Missouri, Lake of the Ozarks thing. How do those people, I don't see those people as being the type that would go and self-quarantine for 2 weeks now. I don't know, just something about that group. So what does that look like in a couple of weeks? And we'll know. The good news is Georgia and Florida have kind of opened up, and it hasn't been huge spikes. So, that there are positives there, and we all want positives. Basically, Larry, I think right now people in charge of sports are not the commissioners and not the owners. They're kind of in charge. But who's really in charge is mayors and governors. And so, for example, the mayor of Chicago, Lori Lightfoot, issued a statement. Now, this is maybe, 3 or 4 weeks ago now, where she said, "I really miss my White Sox," and then, cute, in parentheses, "Okay, and the Cubs too." A total dig at the Cubs from a White Sox fan. Very funny. But she said, went on to explain things. This is a few weeks ago, so things may be changing in Chicago. But the mayor said, but right now Chicago is not playing. So it doesn't matter what Rob Manfred says, or the Ricketts family says, or who owns the White Sox, Ryan Source, whoever. It doesn't matter. The mayor has said they're not playing. And we know the governor there, J.B. Pritzker, also has been obviously very concerned about Chicago. And so they're in charge. So, and we want them to be in charge. because they have the information. The leagues are, have plenty of health officials, but they don't have the information governors and mayors have. So anyway, I think that it's wise and it's smart. What I'm hopeful is that there could be some kind of a bubble situation, like what the NBA is talking about, where you could try to pull something off, a tournament maybe. But even then, you've got players in hotels. And what happens for the workers in the hotel who go home, and then grandpa at home is sick, and then they come back and deliver room service, and now all the Utah Jazz have it. Obviously, that's a scenario. That is a made-up story. But that's the problem with the bubble idea. But I'm glad they're trying. I mean, I think we all can agree. We want them to try. Plans are important. It's good to have plans. They're working with people like you, George. You guys are talking about it. Let's have a plan. Let's talk about it. Let's hope it can happen. And then just see what the next, you know, 6 or 8 weeks bring.
George, you know, the I think it was the Premier League is getting back on the field. I saw a story that said 900 and some odd players got tested, two tested positive, and they are going to be quarantined for 7 days, and the rest of the players play on. And, you know, soccer is a pretty physical sport. Some people don't think so, but all the slide, the people are really touching and they're close, and all the things that we think could contribute to transmission are there. So do you think that, you know, maybe the timing of this is such that these are real good learnings for the league and for the hall? Because by the time we get around to the 1st of August, we're still, you know, we're still a couple months away from that time. And how much time does a pro football team or organization or organization like the hall need to be able to prepare to put on a football game?
I think the hall and football teams are ready immediately. I don't think the issue is the getting the ready. It's the ready under what circumstance. But let me rewind on something. So the last 30 days, we've seen in some shape or form, 30 states roll back out of the shutdown. And what I think has happened here is that each state is so individual, and people who come into it, what nursing homes were most affected, we all know the stats, three states have X amount of the deaths in the United States. But it's sort of like following a successful NFL team. Everybody took a dip in the water. Now they're going to evaluate. And I think you're going to see the same thing happen with sports leagues the next 30 days. It started with this great NHL plan. And I'm going to give you a bubble plan of a friend of ours that we know that got a little publicity last weekend. And that's World Team Tennis. World Team Tennis, led by Commissioner Carlos Silva, my favorite Greek-a-Rican, Puerto Rican Greek. And last year, actually, Hall of Fame Productions produced 10 hours of television for Carlos for 1 week of matches, and we were slated to do it in New York this week. But Carlos did a brilliant pivot job, which was really interesting. He is going to be there because they have 62 matches all on television in a three-week period, July 17th to August 2nd, and they made a deal with the Greenbrier. So all their players will be there. They have two outdoor courts. They have an indoor court. They'll meet all their TV obligations. And the 3,000-seat arena, the governor will allow 500 people to begin with, and he'll see how it goes, and maybe 1,000. Now, I think we can't be – the NFL is not going to be a bubble. I think baseball is moving, as Tommy said, to a bubble situation. They'll see this NHL example, which seems to be moving down the road. But I do think that you're going to see, and it started with Governor Cuomo, I'm a Bills fan, and the Bills can train in Buffalo, okay? He opened that up, yeah, sort of out of the blue.
Yes.
I think you're going to see.
With these statistics for baseball.
Hey, Nick, your mic's on, Nick.
You're trying to produce.
Nick, your mic's on.
Exactly. Nick, you're on the air. You're killing us. Yeah, I think you're going to see sort of this gradual rollout. But to Christine's point, I'd like to
revenue $750 million.
Turn off your mic, Nick. Nick, your mic is on, Nick. Your mic is on, Nick. You're interrupting your own program.
To Christine's point, the sooner you start seeing this rollout, then you'll see the effects, because football is the most closest sport. The other sports, you can sort of make an argument. NBA, not, you know, not the great. Tennis, obviously, that's a great distance sport, like golf is a great distance sport. Baseball, mostly can be a distance sport. Football, you cannot be a distance sport and play football. So I think that in the rollout, they'll give them the 2 weeks to see if they can do it or not, and then we'll know. look, the experts, the medical experts said they need 4 weeks of training. So they have to know they can get to camp by that second week of July. I think they'll try to get to camp earlier in mini camps to see how it works together. And then they'll test it like the states have tested their rollouts.
So to sports on the field, to what type of teams? I've got a pretty strong opinion here because the Redskins have a first-year head coach, and you can talk about teams that were playing well when the pandemic hit. To what teams does this roll out, when it happens and how it happens? Which teams have the advantage? And, Christine, you mentioned Kansas City. Somebody here mentioned Kansas City. They're probably on the field practicing right now. Who knows? I mean, you've got the Super Bowl winner. The coach has been there a long time. The system is in place. The players have been there. Not a lot of turnover on that team because they have cap issues. So, to me, it's a clear advantage for a team like that versus a team that has a first-year head coach who have yet to meet their players. So, what are your thoughts on the competitive level? If they try to keep it balanced, yes, but there are some inherent issues that aren't going to be fixed by delaying the start of camp.
Oh, absolutely, Larry. And I would love, when I finish, I want to ask you, I'd love to hear what you have to think and what you can say about that. About the, you know, obviously the team most people in this city care about. I agree with you. In fact, what this calls for, and you're going to know exactly who I'm going to say, this calls for Joe Gibbs. If there's a better organizer in all of sports in terms of being on top of something, I don't know who it is. I mean, I'll take names other than Gibbs. Two of the three Super Bowls that he won here in Washington, he won during strike years, as you well know, 82 and 87. So while everyone else is losing their minds, New York Giants, remember, they didn't even care about replacement players, George Young and that gang in 87, and Gibbs, and not just Gibbs, but Bobby Bethard, Charlie Casserly, and Jack Ken Cook, the owner, happens from the top down, put it together, had a plan, really signed free agents, really went after guys, won those three replacement strike games, whatever, and went on to, those games counted, and went on to make the playoffs, and then, of course, win the Super Bowl against Denver in January of 88. So, you know, someone like a Joe Gibbs, and I know you know this well, Larry, would be the perfect person. Keep their head, keep calm, and have a great organization in place. So, to your point, will we see the least turnover of any league, any, you know, jumbling of order from one season to the next, maybe in all of these sports? You know, do the Washington Nationals come in? Baseball's different, obviously, but do they come in with this built-in advantage? Maybe not so much. But football, because of the time and the timing and the need, you need all the, you know, the cadence, the practice, the just knowing each other, quarterback to receiver, all of the things, the offensive line, you know, and how they work together, which we saw here in Washington when I was so lucky to cover the team and watch those guys, Jacoby, Graham, Bostic, et cetera, Mark May. I would say that. I would say absolutely. We may see the NFL order, the standings, so to speak, be almost similar. I agree with you. I think it's really tough to put a new system in. And while I'm a big fan of Ron Rivera, and he's a really good guy, and I think Washington's in good shape with him, it is going to be hard. But I'm curious, what do you think? To answer your question, how would you answer?
Here's the way I feel, and I think in the NFC East, Philadelphia has a huge advantage because you've got Doug Peterson, you've got, but I think they have a quarterback problem, or they wouldn't have drafted a quarterback out of Oklahoma, and they've got some issues on defense too. But the system's in place. Doug Peterson is an outstanding coach. I think he's one of the big strengths of their team. On the positive side, you've got three other teams in the NFC East. Dallas has a first-year coach. The Giants have a first-year coach, and the Redskins have a first-year coach. The Redskins' first-year head coach started January 1st on the job. He had his staff. He cherry-picked people from Carolina. A lot of people wondered, you know, hey, they didn't win last year. Why is he bringing those guys? Because they know what he expects, and they got very well prepared before the pandemic. They didn't know the pandemic was going to hit, but they were ahead of schedule with their installation and getting everything out there. How they deal with these Zoom calls and these Zoom meetings, everybody's doing everything virtually now, so I can imagine there's some guys probably falling asleep during those meetings because they fell asleep when they're in the auditorium anyway. But Ron Rivera coached during a strike-shortened season at the beginning of his Carolina career. He told me he didn't need his team until 2 weeks before the season started, so he's going to tap into that experience, definitely at a disadvantage. I like the fact it's him. Like you say, he's a very likable guy. He's a stand-up guy. He's what the team has needed for so many years. someone who's going to hold the players accountable and hold himself accountable. And so it is a breath of fresh air with him being here. Got the chance to meet him and know him over 2 months. And wow, to some extent, like Coach Gibbs, even to a greater extent, Ron Rivera came through the building. He wanted to meet every single person. He told me he wanted to meet every person in my department. He wanted to meet everybody. Now, Joe would do that the day after a win. He'd come by and shake everybody's hand. Ron approached it very differently. He wanted to completely change the culture in the building. And he did so, but to preempt that effort has kind of slowed the effort down because everybody's not here. So I guess it puts us back to being in a bigger disadvantage than they might have been as a first-year head coach. Because you know, Christine knows, a lot of folks might not know that you got a first-year head coach, you get to start a week early. You get an extra mini camp. You get all kinds of advantages. And this team would have reported to Redskins Park on April the 16th, and they still haven't showed up. And they haven't really met most of each other, even though these guys do get together despite the quarantine. They're getting together. Dwayne Haskins probably throwing the ball around on a high school field somewhere, just like those Redskins did up the road here in Herndon during the strike year. And Christine, you were probably waiting for him to come off the field back then, weren't you?
I was. Darryl Grant putting his hand into the – you remember when he beat the window?
He was a union activist. He was a union
activist. He was. And Dexter Manley, good old Dexter, was sneaking across the picket line, not because he was crossing the picket line, but because he had to go to his locker. He forgot his shoes. He throws his bathrobe over his head. And then all the cameras – Larry, we're all on the picket line, not walking it, but covering this, right? Yeah. And at the old park. And you got every TV there and whatever. And here comes this big figure with this white terry cloth robe over his head. It gets caught in the door. So all of a sudden it falls off and, of course, reveals Dexter with his shoes in his hand. And, you know, those were some hijinks back in the day. But absolutely, you know, I'm curious, you know, and maybe you've already dealt with this. I apologize in the time that I missed. But, Tommy, how hard is it for a player to stay in shape? I know you want to stay in shape.
Yeah.
When you're – right? When you're working on a high school, to Larry's point, on a high school field by yourself or with your kid or maybe you find someone that, you know, play catch with you or pitch to you, a high school teammate or something from the past. How hard is that?
Yeah, I mean, I went through the strike year, you know, I was in the lockout in 90 and then obviously the strike year in 94 when we struck and went into the spring training in 95, you know, of the how short in time. And that, I'm going back as my thought as a baseball player, not as an analyst or anything like that, is nothing prepares you for game than game situations. And that's what spring training is for pitchers. I mean, you can be in the best shape in the world, I think, throwing in a high school gym, throwing to a catcher, you know, at the high school or whatever, going down to spring training. But once guys start getting in the box, like in game situations, and you're throwing on that field for BP and stuff, the adrenaline kind of gets going a little bit. You kind of stretch out a little bit more. And those are the crucial times where some guys get sore, some guys get sore again a little bit, and they have to, you know, just take themselves a step back a little bit. You have to learn your body. One of the quotes you hear every first day of camp, you can't make the team the first 2 weeks, don't try. Hey, take it easy, get into it, get into a flow, you know, nothing prepares you for it, but other than doing it. That's my major concern with starting this season. They're saying 3 weeks. Okay, they got to have something in place because it's not going to be a game based on the starting pitchers going five innings anymore or whatever. Like, I think it's going to be based on they got to open up the rosters and have enough pitching to where they can, you know, everybody can go to a three innings, that type of thing. So, I think that's what you're going to see. It's going to be different because you do have guys that have contracts right now that are, I mean, major contracts. They're paying guys major money, and you're risking the health of trying to rush them to get ready. And that's the major concern, I think, are the pitchers. And it is. I think spring training is made for the pitchers to kind of get stretched out in a little bit. And the relievers are more so, you know, they can throw that inning or two. But it's all about the back-to-back days, getting up and down. Can you do that? It's about the training of the body. And nothing else prepares you for that than getting in that situation where the juice is flowing that stretches you out a little bit, and that's what gets you in shape, finally.
I see Nick has reappeared.
Yes, I have magic. Magically, here I am. One of the great things about being a sponsor of these events is I can interject myself when I want to and being able to ask a question. And I'd like to do that at this time before everyone has to vanish at 1 o'clock to their next Zoom. I got a specific question for Tommy Green, and then the other one is a little bit more general to the entire panel. We have seen work stoppages in the world of athletics numerous times. World Series have been canceled because of strikes and other things, which comes down usually to money.
Yeah.
This time we are dealing with health-related issues. Notwithstanding the NFL, that is still a ways to go, and hopefully by then things will come back to some form of normalcy. Is it possible that at this point we've just passed, the point of no return, and should we just say, the hell with it? They just kick, just get rid of this season, the NHL, the NBA, and MLB, and just say, they just start next season, and for the good of it all, just forget about it. And a more specific question to Tommy, as a former MLB player, if you were playing today, notwithstanding your previous comments about getting into shape, how comfortable would you be under the things that you hear today of trying to start MLB baseball again, to go out on the field, and then, of course, interacting with your family as well? That's my two questions.
Oh, that's a very good question. And the only thing that probably would keep me from doing it would be my family, and me possibly bringing something back to them, because you got more considered than just yourself. It is your family, and that comes down to my statement. One of my things I said about the Major League Baseball having a set, having the plan about how they're going to do things. Like the Phillies are going to have their spring training, by what I hear, things get going at Citizens Bank Park. They're not going down to Florida. They're staying here, to do that. Are they going to have the things in place where they're testing all the time and everybody's kind of, keeping following the rules the best they can. That means a lot. The situation, some guys need the money, some guys don't. That plays a factor. If sort of like the strike years when they were asking guys to cross the lines and some guys and finding other guys that used to play or even as they call scabs to come in and play. Some guys were doing it for dreams. Some guys were doing it because they needed it. And that's things you got to take care of to survive a little bit. And nobody knows everybody's situation. So, but I know me personally. In that situation, my family would take first precedence, and if there's nothing in place, I'm not playing.
I got an email question from our good friend Jim Stuker for Christine.
George, can I just get the other question in I asked regarding it? Should we just forget about
just the season? Well, I think that's certainly a possibility, Nick. Just have nothing until 2021, and that is heartbreaking, right? And not just for us, for me in my career, Larry, for you, we obviously continue to be, there's many stories to do during this time. So I'm as busy as ever. So I'm not even thinking about me at all. But not only the fans, but also Nick, Tommy, as you were talking, think about the guys, this was going to be the year to break in, right? I know a young man, a father of a young man who was pitching in the in one of the major league organizations and actually got a chance to start a spring training game out of college, right? So now this is his chance.
Yeah.
If there's next year, well, it might still be his chance, but of course then you get a whole other group of seniors who are going to graduate. So you're now literally jumbling up, two classes entering if you don't have this. Same with all the, how about the WNBA, the great Bella Allery. I know Bella, obviously her dad's Mark Allery, her mom Renee Augustine, dear friends of mine. Bella got drafted fifth in the WNBA draft. And right now she's not in Dallas, and she'll be fine. She's excellent from Princeton, great, great player. But all these WNBA, NBA draft choices, all of them MLB draft, NHL, all of them, this is their time. And to lose a year when most of these careers are 3 or 4 years anyway, right? It's a tough one. But I do think, Nick, absolutely there is a strong, I don't know, is it more than 50% chance? I don't know. And George, you might know better than I, that we will not have any pro sports back until 2021.
I don't know.
I mean, and another thing, I mean, I'm sorry, George, real quick, was another thing I need to hit on before it gets too late. We've talked about the major league sports, but consider the minor league players, the guys they're, you know, they count on this for a little bit, way of make a little bit of a living too. And Christine, you know, that's another people were, they were in line to possibly get that shot, you know, in spring training, those guys that were minor league guys getting a chance to go up to big league camp and shine. And now they've lost that year. Same way with the college seniors and the juniors that were supposed to be drafted. It's a huge, huge thing. I think baseball's got a chance, you know, because they can back the season up some, you know, but they really need – they got to come together now, you know, put the stakes on the eyes a little bit to take the black eyes away a little bit because they've been talking it's about money and stuff now. They need to find a way to get on to do it so they can go out there and play and have some positive – by the end of the season. If not, that I think the cancellation might be, you know, inevitable.
I was going to say, I don't think it's all or nothing. Look, golf is coming back. Race cars coming back in a different way. Your NHL is coming back. I believe in the trine with time and where those chips fall, who knows? And what formats they fall in different ways, who knows? But you know, the Patriots were down, 29-3 to the Falcons. They had a 1.4 chance of coming back in the Super Bowl. We're not out of the game here. And teams and leagues understand to play within rules. I want to offer you just one quick thing on football. And being a former trainer and ball boy and having had that whole life with my uncle in sports medicine. Look, the National Football League and the Players Association have done a tremendous job of reducing the amount of contact time. The theory, never proven yet, it would reduce injuries, increase longevity, et cetera. I have to tell you, these guys who maintain themselves in better shape off-season, whether they're at OTAs or not, and you've been seeing the incredible story of Kirk Cousins that's going on, and you see that virtual reality thing going on, you know, could they get ready in 2 weeks with a body that hasn't been battered or bruised or beaten? Who knows? Well, I'll tell you one thing. If you're one of those 65% players who make $1 million or less and could get cut from the squad and the guys who voted this new deal in, you're coming to camp. So there are so many – this story has so many layers and variables. It's not told yet. Forget the percentages. We're going to see the story really unfold here. For you, Christine, it's like open field running the next 2 months. The layers of this thing are phenomenal.
Go ahead, Larry, you wanted to give that question.
Yeah, our good friend Jim Stuger, and he had pointed this to Christine, but it could be, I could kind of generalize it. He talks about the country anxious for baseball to begin. Players and owners are at odds. Last time there was a work stoppage, it took Major League Baseball 12 years for attendance to recover. Some fans walked away. If the players and owners don't get together to agree to terms, the fans might depart in droves. Our thoughts on this in the future of Major League Baseball, I guess that is definitely a fair question. How would baseball be impacted if this was the reason they didn't get back on the field? And I've got an opinion on that. Tommy, let's start with you. If it was a matter of them not agreeing to terms and the season is canceled because they can't agree, what's the impact long term?
I mean, for the fans, like we hit on at the beginning of things, the fans are not – they're very knowledgeable, especially up here in this area. And I think it would be a long term effect with the fans about coming back afterwards if they can't come to some kind of agreement money wise. If it's something else because of the health risk and stuff like that, that might be something that's a different issue. But if it's money wise, fans are going to have an issue with it. I think if they can't find a common ground, I think that's it in a nutshell.
I agree with that. I agree with that 100%. Christine, what are your thoughts on that?
I think there's a real question about fans, not necessarily because they don't want to come, but because they might be afraid to come. I mean, that's another piece of this puzzle. As long as we don't have a vaccine or treatments, and that's another, I've talked to epidemiologists for columns, a treatment can also be as good as a vaccine. We have a treatment for AIDS and HIV, and look at the change, right, in that. Magic, it was a death sentence when he got it, when we all heard that news, and what was that, 89, 90? And of course, Magic Johnson is alive and well. And so treatments are a possibility too. And we know that we've got a space race going on here, right? Around the world, every scientist, researcher, doctor, everyone is working so hard. So there is hope there too. I don't want to be Debbie Downer. There's a lot going on, and there's a lot of wonderful people around the world. Thank goodness for them working so hard to find vaccines or treatments. But until we have that, who's going to really feel comfortable going to a game? 90 degrees at, you know, not just a Washington Nationals or a Phillies game, Nick. I know you probably feel okay with the Phillies game, but what about a college football game this fall? What, you want to pack 100,000 people into Ohio State, into Columbus, Ohio, and not an 80 degree September day? I don't think so. And so I think all sports across the board are going to look at this until there's a vaccine, and that, you know, could be, and everyone's vaccinated too, which is, you know, we're talking at least a year or so on that. But I think that George is right about like the world team tennis, that model, 500 fans, just like restaurants, right? Our restaurants that we love, they're, hopefully they'll come back, but they're not going to have 100%. A restaurant that could have had 100 people a night now might have 20 or 30 or whatever a night. And it's going to be very different, but I think sports fans will also adapt. But that's why the television component here is so important, because it's going to be a TV show for most people. Even ardent fans who just might say, I don't think we're going to go to the ballpark, but we'll watch and cheer, you know, from afar. I think we're going to see that. And I think that's a real problem, obviously, for the fiscal side of all of these sports the next year or so.
George, ratings are going to go up, George, aren't they?
Here's all the golf rating, greatest sports cable golf show since the Masters, the 4.9. You saw that unbelievable draft rating, just multi-millions. And I can tell you, we've had record-breaking social media numbers. We just did a 1.5-hour TV show on the web with the governor of Ohio, young teenagers being talked to by Anthony Munoz and Daryl Green and Aeneas Williams about how to survive during the COVID. We had 8 students. We got like, it was ridiculous, 35,000 viewers. It was like a TV show. But I'm going to have to run to my next TV show. So I want to thank you, Nick. I got to go.
Thank you, George. I appreciate it.
Well, Christine, good
well.
Stay in touch. Get you, Tommy. Enjoy your Greek night when you see Nick against some souvlaki. Okay?
You will, George. Take care. I know we're almost out of time, but I'd like to try to get one life's questions in from Gregory Stamis, who runs the HEPA athletic programs out of Connecticut. He says, the maxim, albeit arguably debatable, has long been that, quote, sports teaches lessons and thus prepares one for life. So what lessons from sports can be applied to help us navigate through this new world we find ourselves in?
Wow, how about, okay, go ahead, Tommy.
Oh, I'm sorry. What has sports taught me how to tread life a little bit? It's about to get where I got to, I had to persevere through the ups and downs. It's like I talk to kids. It's all about making the waves instead of being peaks, and you're having these high cresters like this. You won't roll in waves through life. We're going through now where we're going through something right now that we got to persevere and stay consistent with. And in the long run, if we do that, we will come out the other side. And that's what baseball and athletics has taught me, basketball, football at a young age, is how to persevere and keep going.
Especially in baseball, that you fail 70%, 80% of the time, yes, and you're still considered pretty good.
True. But I kept most of those guys at the 300 level anyway. I pitch. A lot of guys got hits off of them.
Christine, any comment on that?
Yeah, well, I think a couple of thoughts. One is, certainly patience, right? And most of us who are type A personalities, who are go-getters and run through brick walls, I think, you know, we probably all four of us in that category. You've got to have patience now. And you've got to let things happen as opposed to make things happen. I mean, you can still make things happen within your life, your family life, you know, stay healthy, eat right, right? Walk and do all the things we're all hopefully doing and feeling, you know, good physically and getting that, you know, mental health, that refreshing feeling being outside or whatever you can do with a mask, of course, or social distancing. But I think patience and just letting this kind of understanding and accepting the unknown really for the first time in our lives. You know, we didn't go through the Depression, obviously. Our parents or grandparents did. We didn't go through World War II. So we're dealing with something that is, you know, it's our big test. And how are we going to be able to, you know, pass this test? And hopefully we will. And Katie Ledecky, the great swimmer from this area, from Bethesda, I've talked to her several times for columns and stories. Obviously, her Olympics, 2020 Olympics, are not going to happen, postponed for a year. And when I talked to her the day after the postponement, Nick, Katie Ledecky, obviously just one of the greats of all time in the Olympics, said, all right, I now know that it won't be this year. She goes, I'm going to take a couple days, and then I'm going to set a new, get a calendar out and start setting a new plan in terms of swimming and distances and mental things and everything, and start to organize my life for July of 2021. That is the mark of a champion. And I think all of us listening, any of us who have kids or nieces, nephews, grandkids, whatever, who are in sports, anyone out right now listening, tell those kids, or even the young, or maybe the pros, if you know someone. I don't know, Tommy, if you would agree with this. Maybe get out a journal, write every now and then, write your thoughts. You know, it'll help you feel better. And also start to have a plan. As someone said, win the practice, win this time, win COVID-19. While you're not playing your game, while you're not practicing, high school, college, pro, whatever it is, just start to organize and be ready for whatever. As Katie Ledecky said, be ready. Okay, it's not 2020, it's 2021. New plan, here we go. And I think remaining positive during all this is very important.
Larry, any final comments, Larry? Because I know you have to go.
Well, Christine took it all. She took it all. I had three words, and she mentioned them all. Patience, planning, and positivity. And each of those, you're going to learn something about yourself. When it comes to positivity, you got to control what you can control. You can't control what's happening out there, but you can take care of yourself. You can make sure you're safe, your family's safe. And then as you get out a little bit, as things begin to unfold, you better have a plan for when it happens. And the patience part, we've been tested. I know everybody's been tested. Some people at the end of their ropes right now. And sports will return in whatever form. I mean, I'm watching the NASCAR races. I've never been really a NASCAR fan. But I think it was kind of interesting watching a competition, watching some of the drivers try to cheat to win. I mean, that's what competition's all about. If you're not cheating, you're not trying. So
I like that.
So that's maybe a good way to wrap it up, Nick.
Well, you know, whatever one can do to bring sports closer to themselves. I read a story the other day about somebody building miniature Dodger Stadium in their backyard. So I guess you know, that kept them busy. On behalf of the American Hellenic Institute, I certainly want to thank all our panelists here today for, I think, what was really a very good discussion, broad discussion on all the facets of sport. Larry Michael, now we know why you win all these Emmy Awards. A tremendous job, but thank you so much for your participation and all of you for participating in another AHI event. To our audience out there, this will conclude this edition of our virtual speakers forum. We will take a break next week, but please come back with us on June 10th when we will get back into our hardcore AHI discussions. There's an agency called the Commission on International Religious Freedom. They put out an annual report every year on countries that violate religious freedoms. Well, in our case, Turkey is one of the most egregious violators of religious intolerance. And we will have a discussion with another group of panelists to bring that issue to the forefront. So until then, I'd like to thank what now are becoming sort of my producers on the show. And that's Emily Pantis. And of course, Elias Yarosulis, my two staff members who are working remotely from their homes. I'd like to thank them. Thank you all again to the panelists. And thank you all out there for tuning in today. Have a good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, guys.
Bye, everybody. Take care.
Take care.